Hi, this is Dorit. Welcome back. Yeah, I'm back to talk about something quite serious about Satan, how he really tricked me in my youth and why abstinence is important. So after the death of my brother and sister, I prayed and had many questions like, why did Jesus have to be crucified and to die so early, like only 33 years old, according to the Bible? Jesus later taught me it was because of the sin of mankind and my sin and our faithlessness. He basically carried all our sin. In school, we continued to study the Bible, not in depth and not about how to apply it in life. Plus, we kind of learned that the Bible was like an old book with lots of stories, almost like a myth. Later, I learned this is God's story about how real people battled for God against Satan all through biblical history, plus how God worked to restore the fall of man and bring the Messiah, Jesus Christ, who is walking God and true man, who came to save man. But is it historically correct and reliable? What criteria is there for a historical document? According to Jess McDowell, he was challenged by a Christian group on his college campus to make a rigorous examination of the claims about Jesus Christ, that he is God's son, that he inhabited a human body and lived among real human beings and died for our sins. From the book More Than a Carpenter, plus there's many talks on, also on his website, www.joss.org. What criteria is there for a historical document? Number one, when was it written? How long after the event was it written? And by who? And number two, how many manuscripts does it have? And number three, archaeological proofs. So let's look at the Bible. We first look at the Old Testament. They found 10,200 manuscripts from the Old Testament in a synagogue in Cairo and also from the Dead Sea Scrolls. I went to Israel myself, and there they told a story about how the little shepherd boys found the Dead Sea Scrolls in the caves. The Old Testament was written, started to get written 1500 BC, first by Moses on papyrus scrolls. But one thing about the Jewish people, they were very exact in telling the stories over and over again. And when they started writing them down, they had people whose job was just to transfer, just to write the Bible down. If you look at the New Testament, it has over 5,800 complete or fragmented Greek manuscripts and 10,000 Latin manuscripts and 9,300 manuscripts in various other ancient languages. That's about 25,100 manuscripts. And they were all written within the first 100 years after Jesus was born. So Jesus lived from about 0 to 33 AD, so that's like 20 to 80 years difference. So many of them were written by his disciples. Plus many archaeological findings from that age as well. Then we can compare with other old writings, like Homer. He lived like 900 BC, and his writings was written down about 400 BC, which is a difference of 500 years. And he have only about 1,000 manuscripts. That's the most manuscripts of ancient writings after the Bible. And Plato, he lived like 427 BC, and it was written down about 900 AD, which is about 1,200 years different. And there's only about 7 manuscripts. And you know how often both the Homer, the Iliad, and Plato gets talked about in college and everywhere. You can check it out yourself on Jess McDowell's, you know, website, and do some research and study some of his video. So my conclusion is that this is the most reliable ancient book, and it's inspired by God, and it's written down by man. So in my youth, I did not listen to God much. It was not in to go to church. I stopped reading the Bible. We all got confirmed in the Lutheran church. But our focus was on how many presents we would get, how much money we would get for presents, you know. And then, you know, when you're 15 in Denmark, you're allowed to drink. Everyone drank, family, friends, even the priest. And if you did not like it, you ask, what's wrong with you? Everyone is drinking. Everyone does it. No warning about you would lose perception of what was right and wrong when you drank. Like research have found that teen drinkers have 6 times greater risk of having sex, and drug-using teens are 5 times more likely to have sex. This is from Angetta McQueen, and this study was linked to teenage use of drugs and alcohol to earlier riskier sex, from the Associated Press in 1999. So I started having boyfriends, going to parties, drinking, and my parents said very little. You do not talk about sex, and you don't talk about drinking, and you don't talk about God and what's right and what's wrong. Plus, my dad trusted me too much and gave me too much freedom. My parents did the best they knew. So what happens when you have sex with someone? There's a hormone released that binds you together in both the man and the woman. It's oxytocin, same hormone that's released when a mother breastfeeds her baby, plus other hormones as well. Sex is supposed to be after marriage. Men are visual, so the wife is supposed to be imprinted in their memory. Today we have pornography everywhere. It's a big danger. I'll talk more about that another day. It's supposed to bind you together with each other, the sexual relationship, and God. It's the most beautiful love relationship in marriage between husband and wife, centered on God. And the most precious result is a new creation, God's child. So what happens when you have sexual relationship outside marriage? It's the worst sin. It's like spiritually murdering each other. That's how powerful sex is. In Genesis 1:28, God gives the 3 blessings, the 3 jobs to men. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." Fruitful means to become mature. That's the first job we have. Then multiply means having a family centered on God. Dominion or sovereignty over all things, having our own home, little kingdom, for you are the king and queens, co-heirs with Christ, the King of Kings, and being ready to defend it. So I'm very happy now to have a good, faithful husband I can trust, who loves me, and I respect him deeply. And we have 5 boys. I'll share more later. So what can happen if you have sex outside marriage? Unplanned pregnancy. Are you mature and ready to take care of another new little child? Many choose abortion and kill their own child. I'll talk more about abortion another day. Sexual transmitted diseases. There's about 20 now, and many incurable and deadly, or you cannot get pregnant afterwards. Age is one of them. There's also behavioral risk with having early, like teenage sex. It's a higher level of self-destruction behaviors among boys, like alcohol misuse, drug misuse. I know even some of my friends became alcoholics or drug addicts. Running away from home, getting arrested. And this is from the National Center for Health Statistics. And in addition, for the girls who have sex, there's like 2 or 3 times higher risk to be lonely, upset, or attempt suicide. So abstain from sex till you get married. Wait. Then it is wonderful and safe. You can start over. That is what I did. For years I had no sexual relationship. It was liberating. I did not have to worry about unwanted pregnancy, AIDS, hurt, abuse. I could focus on growing in my relationship to God, Jesus, and others as my brothers and sisters, and live for others. So next time, I want to talk about why is there so much misuse of sex in our society, in history, in the world. Okay, have a great day. God bless. Bye-bye.